project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation and by Berks Arts Council.
Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Live, I'm James Carroll, and with me as my guest this evening is Dolores Kirschner.
Right.
And Kirschner is spelled K-I-R-S-C-H-N-E-R.
Right.
And Dolores is a ceramist sculptor. And where do you live?
Pikeville, 5 miles from Ole and 5 miles from Boyertown, right in the middle.
Between Boyertown and Ole.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And also she has a program which is called Clay on Main over in Ole, which is an incredible little organization.
Thank you.
It's one that everybody should be able to see, watch, and be able to enjoy.
Thank you.
But it happens because of her excitement and enjoyment in making things with clay, and or the distortion of clay.
That's a better
or. Decomposing clay.
Yeah.
Why don't you give us a little synopsis of
what
you do,
yeah,
how you think, so that as we go along, then they sort of have something to grab to
I guess I was trained at a very traditional time in a very traditional city, in a very traditional media, that my background is in ceramics and pottery. I sort of have abandoned that through the years, and I still enjoy the material, but I've tried to work beyond what the traditional boundaries of what most people think of as pottery would be, to go into a more sculptural end of the work.
You mean unitary?
Right. Like
functional objects like a pot, a teacup.
Yeah, a teakettle, a vase. That I have all that traditional background, like these things here.
But it's something. You know, a vase usually is something that will hold water.
That's our joke in the studio.
You make it so it doesn't hold
water. That's our joke in the studio. Matthew and I say, if it holds water, it's not a success. what I like is to push that media to its boundaries, to use that iconic shape. In fact, I have an image here that really, I think, illustrates that. Let's find that. This image here is just a vase. It's a vase.
It's coils?
These are slabs.
They're slabs.
Here's another image of it. And all of these series of pieces are vases. I mean, I call them vases. That's simply all they are, is vases. But their surface is so modeled, there's all kinds of things creating that texture on the surface. But that is sort of an iconic, it's an iconic image of ceramic art, of traditional functional vessel. But that's now, it's, I've hoped that it's become something else in a sculptural, and that's kind of what I'm trying to do. Instead of fighting against all my traditional background, I'm just pushing it to another
edge. We will show during the, the course of the hour.
Yeah, that's what I'm, that's kind of my overview.
Okay, what is the first object that you would like to bring up?
Look at these cylinders here. These are porcelain cylinders that are eggshell thin. I have one here also.
You mean this one right here?
Yeah, that one. It's a series. This is a series. And over the years, as I've worked with clay, one of the things that really excited me is how I can really change the texture of that clay, still retain some of its glass-like qualities, but make it something different. So,
could I have you bring the camera over and play with this form?
Yes. So this is something that I was really intrigued with a few years ago. As I said, these are eggshell thin. I mean, you could crush
right
that with
in,
your hand.
Come right in with a detail. Yeah. Close up.
I think if you wanted to, you could crush that, which again.
Because you can see it's paper thin.
It's paper thin, right.
And it's almost like you can, like a chip.
Right, that's right. You could crush it with your hands.
Yes.
And that's what I found very intriguing about doing this, as opposed to what we think of as like clay vessels that are centuries old. You know, this, you could just crush this with your hands. And
This doesn't even, wouldn't even hold.
Oh, no,
broke.
That's all right. Oh, boy, James.
Well, look here. See how thin
Yeah,
it
that's
is.
How thin it is. That's See why I only bought one. that's something that I'm working on.
See, it's very fragile in a way.
Very fragile. And that's what intrigues me, though, is the materials. Is that
it's even more interesting.
Yeah. Because you have this really cool clay stuff, and you think of clay, like, it would last forever,
what
right?
What kind of clay is this?
That's porcelain.
Porcelain?
Mm-hmm, porcelain slip.
Mm-hmm. So it's you fire this at a much higher level.
Yeah, that's about 2,300 degrees. And that's what has that little glassy sheen to it. It has no glaze. It's just the porcelain starting to...
It's kind of matty in a way, but it's it isn't very porous.
No, it's vitreous, because the porcelain at that temperature will get like that. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that's something that, you know, that idea that clay, finished clay, could be that fragile, and something that I enjoyed working with.
So. Yeah, those are...
I like those, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have a good feel to them.
They do, don't they? So yes. That's something I'm still working on. I haven't quite perfected where that's going yet, but I'm working on that.
And you say as we go along that you work in a series. And what determines if it's a few or a number larger than a few?
You know, I think that sometimes my objects, you know, you look at those, you think, okay, that's a vase. But it's not really a vase. It has those piercings through it. As I said, it may not hold water. But that wasn't the object. The object of it was to be a sculptural, something sculptural. So there's two reasons I think I work in a series. One is I work in a series, like this has seven pieces. First of all, because just the nature of the way the material is made, I can throw them quickly and then experiment with them. I might make 20 and then end up with 6 or 5 that I like and keep those. And that's kind of the neat thing about clay is, you know, I got a bunch of kids, I got a busy life. And
like
so.
You've got something black in
here. And that's manganese and slip mixed together. It's an oxide and slip mixed together. And then I pushed it out from the back to accentuate the crack.
wherever you had cracked.
Wherever it was cracked, because
that's almost like a nose.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I wanted to accentuate those cracks.
If you could, come in with the camera and get some close-up shots.
And I think the other reason that I work in series is to give your eye a context. You know, it's fun to to let your eye see things in a series. You know, so you think, okay, well, that's one thing, and
see,
look, there's another one like it.
See the black?
Yeah, that's an oxide with
sort
slip.
Sort of like a plug.
Yeah, that's what it was. That's exactly
plugging
what it was.
Plugging up the breaks in it.
I threw the pieces, I damaged them so that they, I pushed them as far as I could push them till they broke.
It's like being on the wheel, and
yeah,
then you go, boom.
Yep, and that's what, from the inside out, I stretched it as far as I could stretch it. And then I filled them up to accentuate those marks. Again, that's coming from that traditional background, whereas, I mean, I can throw, but I wish...
These are sort of like fish, aren't they?
They are kind of like fish. One thing, you know, I look at all the time... there's a couple things I look at. I look at the natural world, flowers, fish, insects, but I don't feel like I need to copy those things. But you just always have that in your back of your mind
here.
No, those
are association because of the shape of
the form. That's right.
You put it in. But if you could take some close-ups of this, you can see some of the fragileness of it.
And porcelain lends itself to that, where you can just, these are hand-built. And they're just pinched so thinly. It really lends itself to that. There's about 15 in this series, and each one is just a little bit different, just a little more elongated. They came from, I'll show you this image.
See, it doesn't have, it's open at both ends.
Right.
So it doesn't have, other than resting like it is,
There's
containers to put stuff in, but not really.
Well, you know, this had the whole vessel thing, you know, that whole vessel thing. Is it a vessel if it doesn't hold something? I mean, you know, and again, I was trained traditionally. I was taught to make cups and bowls and pots and tea kettles and casseroles. That was what my training was. And at that time, you know,
when
it wasn't...
When you made all these things, did you also have to make something to put in it?
Yeah, right, at our potluck, yeah. So these are a vessel of some sort, you know. There are vessels, do they? I mean, that's that whole thing. This image is kind of neat, sort of goes along.
These are like this.
They are, this series, these aren't quite as... These aren't quite as thin. These actually came from an exercise just showing people how to create this type of form.
They look
and
like
then
bones.
They do exactly look like bones, don't they? I don't know that they really were bones.
I mean, from this distance.
Yes, they do.
But are they about the size of this? About
they're about
10
the size
inches,
of that. Yep, they're about the size
long.
Of that. Now, these are not as fragile as these because they were made a little bit differently. But they're very similar to these tubes here. Very similar.
Now it's together.
Now it's all together now, right. Well, that's it. It's so cool to think you could just pick it up in your hand and crush it. I mean, clay shouldn't be like that, right?
Well, I don't know, but the way it broke, it's much
more
interesting.
Well, because you can see the layers.
Yes.
Yeah, how it's
the
created.
The folds of different
That's right, mm-hmm. The folds
thicknesses.
Of it. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yep. So...
Now we'll take some of these off. Do you want to?
Okay. Find another image. Okay. This image here, I'm going to show these because this is kind of neat. This image here, this is a series of bowls. I think there might have been like 23 bowls or something.
Are they
here.
Like
these are? This is what these are. These are part of those bowls. Again, this is like the vases. This is an iconic ceramic form. I mean, it's a bowl. You know, people come.
But
in
it's harder than hell to eat off of that.
Well, you wouldn't eat off of that, right? It's the Black Death. You wouldn't eat off of that
because these are ultra tactile. the surface is concerned. But, not that it's gigantic, but...
Yeah, it's tactile, yeah. And the other thing is, I always...
Look at that, nice break.
Beautiful.
Isn't it?
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, and that doesn't even bother me. Sometimes my students, their pots will crack or break or something, and I'll say, oh, no, that's great.
Make 100 of those.
But
and what is this on this one here, the white?
It's the same thing as on
this same material here.
This is porcelain slip. It's
and this is clay.
Yeah, this is clay. Mm-hmm.
Oh, so you've mixed porcelain and clay with clay slip.
Right.
Porcelain slip.
This is porcelain slip on paper, and then
very
these
thin.
Are just eggshell thin.
Like
it's applied. It's applied after when I apply the glaze. That's when it's applied. And what I'm working on there is that surface texture. And I kind of see those almost, I know they're 3D objects, but to me...
See the bottom of that, how it's pitted?
Yeah, that's because it's rolled over grog and it
that
has a lot
like
of...
cork.
It has, yeah, it kind of does.
And doesn't it?
It has a lot of grit in it. There's a lot of grit in it that, causes this texture.
Yeah.
And the clay has material in it, and then extra material. This is the glaze. This is
overheated or
No, it's designed to do that. They call them their bead glazes or lava glazes. I'll show you a piece here that has.
So they craze.
They craze and crack like that, and they're for sculptural. That's why it sticks to the pieces. That's like the tiles. This slide here, see the texture on those pieces? If you felt those, they're all bubbly. I don't have one with me, but they're all bubbly and they're textured. And that's a bead glaze. And then this is sort of an adaptation of that. This is a lichen glaze. So it's cool stuff. And this is a neat way to push the envelope in ceramics.
Now in painting, mm-hmm. A way to make this naturally happen mm-hmm. is to have an enamel finish. In other words, where it doesn't have any pores in it.
Okay.
And then you put washes of color on top of it, and what it will do
will
crack and craze. Because it doesn't have any place to cling to.
Okay.
And so what does it do? It searches around for all of them.
Okay.
And
okay.
So enamel is like porcelain. It has no, basically, a minimum number of pores.
Right. This, you can, the reason that this does this is because clay is glazes are three things, a melter, a refractory, and a color. Just something that makes the glaze, the silica, not melt completely off the pots. If your pot's glazed to the kiln
shell, no matter what you do, this won't melt.
That won't melt because I have more refractory material in there.
What is it, a filler?
Clay. It's clay.
Just clay?
A certain type of, like a fire clay. And then it'd have to go really hot, like maybe...
Hotter than porcelain?
Oh, yeah. This is about 2,300 degrees, so it'd have to go way hotter than that to melt it because this clay doesn't melt. And that's sort of how you mess around with them and get them to...
See, having your guests come over and... If you had a set of dishes,
No, you wouldn't want to eat off of this.
It's a whole new revelation.
These are the dishes you can't eat off of.
Oh. Ah, shucks.
So, yeah, can you do? Now, you could eat off of this, except it has no bottom. That's another...
Well, how can you eat off of it?
Well, so you could pretend. You could, like...
Now, this is what?
That's coils, and that's stoneware. That's, again, really high-fire clay, but it's just an oxide on the surface.
See, it sits this way.
It sits this way. It could sit that way.
Could that way, but this is the way it was made.
Yeah.
And it's
this
sort of
has
like...
It could. I have about six of those, too, maybe seven. Because you know what I think when you do a series, when it's something that's, you're not really, your brain, you know, what, is this a pot with a hole in it or something?
Well, you just want to see it in other ways.
You see it in a context. It gives it a context.
Yeah, this looks like a rear end.
It is. These are little torsos. And there's a whole bunch of them. And they're all different.
This looks like legs.
And that, then, it's little torsos. Mm-hmm. And then in here, this has a bead glaze in it, you see?
Yeah.
That
right
has
inside.
That has that bead glaze on it that I showed you on those tubes.
Those are really interesting.
Isn't it pretty? Yeah, it's really pretty. It is designed to bead up like that, you know, so...
I know that it's coil, but...
It's coils.
Interesting because this is sort of like wood.
Yeah.
And then you stain it.
Yeah.
And then you get darker stains
wherever the
crevices are.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. That's right. Exactly right. So...
another one?
Let's see. This is the image of the pieces that I just had at New Arts.
You had these at the New Arts program for 8 weeks. I did.
And
on the wall.
Yeah, on the wall. Right. First, that was great.
First show that went up on the wall.
Yeah, I really liked doing that, and I think there were 24 of these, all different sizes, and these tiles developed from those crazy bowls, that glaze on those bowls. And when I did these tiles, what I really thought about these was that they were 2D objects. Like these, I saw these as paintings, especially when I stuck them up on the wall. So it was fun to, you know, come all the way from a 3D, abandon the, I was trained in 3D, but I keep seeing things as a 2D objects. Like I put the glaze on the surface, and then these pieces are even the right size. They're like the size of those little canvases you can buy. And I see these. I mean, I guess some people might see them.
There isn't any right or up.
No, there's no right or wrong on those.
I mean, sometimes you can see a figure. Or,
yeah, I just
other
did.
Representation of object. Well, that's a natural thing.
Yeah, you can, sure.
That one is familiar with.
Sure, you can, but I just see them. I'm interested in this great, beautiful surface. And
you mean where it's the.
Yeah, crack. What I can do with
it
glaze.
Looks very antique-y.
Yeah.
Where it's gone through. It almost looks like mosaic.
It kind of does here.
Yeah,
and what I can. I'm really.
Or that you had some mistakes and that it kind of got burnt.
Yeah, right. and I got, you know, and it's
they
really...
They were what we call no-nos.
That's the best things, you know, those accidents are the best things. So I was happy to be able to control the glazes to get this crazy non-glazed look. And as I said, I see these as paintings. That's why it was really neat to see them on the wall there.
Now, this is hollow.
It's hollow.
Mm-hmm. It's about a quarter of an inch thick,
mm-hmm.
I would say.
Yeah, it is.
At least the back is.
Mm-hmm. And I made the front. This has some texture on it before the glaze. I made the front, put the sides on, put the back on, and then let it dry a little bit and poked the holes for hanging. And then went back and glazed them second firing. So you have to fire them twice. So they're still using the same traditional ceramic that I learned in Philadelphia in the 70s, but there's
a strong similarities
between these two.
Yes.
This is when I started
with this.
Those vases that I showed you. I had just these things. Well, I was kind of working on them even on these tubes here. Can I show this one? These tubes have a very chalky surface. They have sand and grog and bits stuck in the surface. And I was really trying to work on the surface of the objects. And then from those, I went to those vases, which I stuck giant pieces of stuff in and glazes. And then no glaze on these, under oxides and bits of material. And then I started to work with this surface to try and invent a glaze that would not look like a glaze, would give that really cratering kind of look, but be a glaze that would adhere. And then I finally got it right, I think. I did it here, and these were the best. I think these were the prettiest and came out the best. So some glazes I designed in the studio.
Okay.
What are these? These little gourds?
Those are, they're just, you know, there's a...
Look at the, as you pointed out, on these, you also used one of your...
The elements from the kiln.
one of the elements from the kiln,
yeah.
which broke.
Yeah, the wire from the kiln is really cool to use because there are a few things that won't melt in the kiln, and this is one of them. So I just, I always like incorporating, and inside is when I first started to look at the, trying to get that black crusty look, and I hadn't designed those glazes yet. And then I wanted to add other things to these little pods, so I added things on the inside, and I thought...
That's like putting frosting on.
Yeah, sort of, yeah, exactly. And they do have glazes on the outside, but they're sort of wiped back to create the crusty look of those pods. The neat thing about these little things is that when you do, there's something when you make pottery that I make all of my students do called a pinch pot, and it's really gotten a bad rap, and it's really a nice way to work with clay. It's just sort of you and the clay, and these are all pinch pots. There's about 16 of these, I think.
It's about, pinch type. You just pinch it out.
You just pinch it. You don't need any other tools.
And there's
you
the
just,
inside of one
just,
of them.
Yeah. And this is where I first started to experiment with that black glaze that had lots of oxides in it that wasn't a traditional glaze.
Yeah, these have a in a small sense, you know, like a squash or you know, the
Well,
the
I'm
shell.
Always looking at that kind of.
I mean, that's the first thing.
Yeah, because I like that kind of imagery, and I think that when you make stuff, all that stuff that you look at, you know, insects or pods or the stuff in your garden, you just sort of store it back there, you know, and as you're working, you may not consciously say, and I'm going to make a whole set of pods, but those images just kind of come out there.
Okay, we got a break for a minute.
Okay, all right.
So our station identification, you know, like on the radio.
Okay.
Okay, take it away.
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org.
Arts programming on BCTV is supported by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, Berks Arts Council, and the Wells Fargo Foundation.
Back. Dolores Kirschner is here, and we're talking about her work with, she's a ceramist sculptor, and she also has, working with these ideas over in Ole at Clay on Main. So this is some way, I mean, people can get the idea of clay and playing with clay. It's sort of like a child-adult reference to
right.
it, isn't it? In
right,
other words,
it is.
Not having to go through one process, you can choose your own way.
That's right. That's right. That's right. You don't have to, you know, you sort of can make it your own, and clay is like that. The material lends itself to that. I mean, it really, really does lend itself to
that.
Okay,
what did you have here that...
This image here is some...
Image...
installation piece that I did. I installed
Freeman.
This piece at the Freeman Gallery at Albright, and
that was when? 2 years ago?
Probably 2 years ago. Again, this is working on that same idea of pushing clay to its absolute limits. I work in other materials, but I keep going back to the material because it feels comfortable. And these are something my studio mate and I, Matthew, were messing around with: chicken wire, newspaper, and slip. These are unfired. They, you know, people interpret them as all kinds of things. I have another image of these that might be a little easier to understand. I don't see them as anything horrific or scary. I've had all kinds of interpretations of these images.
I find it at the freezing locker of the butcher.
People tell me that. In fact, the other artists...
Cadavers.
Yeah, that's what people tell me that. I had a lady come in and just stand there, and she said they're like something from the Holocaust. Well, I don't think of them as that at all. I look at insects, and I think of them as mud daub. You know, I look at... There are a lot of insects that make their homes from mud, and that's I'm fascinated with that. Termite mounds, mud daubers, all kinds of stuff. I see them as that, but even more than that, I love the idea that they are simply unfired clay, newspaper, and chicken wire.
The way you do this is you have to impregnate the paper with the clay, correct? You make slip out of it?
We have buckets of slip in the studio all the time because we reclaim clay. In fact, most of these pieces are
done with reclaimed clay. But how do you get it with the paper?
You just lay it over the could we have an image again? I just wanted to show.
What do you want?
I wanted to show this image. See these beautiful strips that just lay across the chicken wire. And what's really neat is clay is heavy, and it's a little tricky, but they just sort of take their own shape. And I just love
that
the
big
idea.
Object that comes down from the top center.
Yeah.
And then it has sort of a ring that you see there.
Right. Right.
And then you have the other jutting out from it, which is going away from it.
And then these bits, these ragged bits at the bottom are just like you do paper mache. It's just, it was a really, really fun way to work with the media, media that I've been working with for 35 years, and something completely new for me. You know, it was like...
New world.
Yeah, it was really fun. It was really fun. The other thing that I've been experimenting with is... unfired clay pieces.
That wasn't done in a number of sets because it was a whole unit, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was a whole unit, yeah.
You had a wood frame, so to speak, from which these were supported and hanging.
I had to think of some way to hang them. At the studio, I have them hanging in the basement in a sewerage locker, and they look really cool there. But I had to think of some way to hang them, so we just created this frame and hung them from that. And we hung them at the studio just from hooks. Do you know where you put your piece in that room? I had them hanging. But this was nicer because they had some height. And what was nice about this is it created, I'm interested with these installations in creating an environment, a place where you can feel the pieces that it as you walk through them at a different level than just seeing objects on a table like this. So this you sort of had a walk through, and the little hooks that they are on make them pivot even if they get a little bit of wind. We were really careful about what hooks we chose and things so that they move a little bit even if you walk through them, so you can sort of...
From the breeze?
Yeah,
walking,
from the breeze, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hopefully that don't make it too...
Yeah, so this was a kind of a fun thing, and it was really fun to work in unfired clay, because...
Well, then it's much heavier. Yes, it's got to be with the moisture that's in there.
Well, it dries out, though.
Yeah, it dries, but it doesn't totally dry. It doesn't dry out.
It dries pretty much, but these are heavy, but they're not that heavy because you've only got a thin layer of slip on the newspaper. But I'll tell you, that's when they put it on there wet, it's really heavy.
Oh, it was.
It's really heavy. So you have to work with it in layers, but... That was a really fun project.
A lot of dripping?
Oh, yeah. It was a mess. Matthew and I did that. It was a mess. We had clay all over the studio.
Well, you should have...
It was a mess.
You didn't have a mess on the floor, though?
We didn't care.
You cleaned it up.
Yeah, we cleaned it
up. You cleaned up your act. Shame.
Yeah, we tried. But this was really fun. This was a good project. I did another piece. I went to India and... I was really touched in India by how little those people have and how much we have and how much we waste. And so when I came home from India, I had to do a show that we were doing at the studio. And I didn't have the heart to make any more things. I just didn't think I needed any more things. And I'm sorry, I don't even have a photograph of these pieces. But I made floor to ceiling, like this piece, but with big fat coils. I made floor to ceiling, unfired coil tubes. And I filled that dining room area with those tubes. They were about this big, and they were tall. They were maybe like, the tallest I could get them was about 6 feet. And I used re-slaked clay to make that. Re-slaked clay is reused clay, because I wanted to reuse material. I didn't want to waste any new material. I didn't fire them because I didn't want to, I didn't need the permanence of the object. And I have that material, that clay, I knocked it down, and I have it in a container. And then I'm going to use that material to make another piece. So that's why this was very liberating to do the unfired clay pieces.
You know, when you were speaking about how little they have there, well, it's kind of interesting because in the last couple of days, they have had their electricity off. And the electricity off in India was twice the size of the population of our country.
I know, I heard that on the radio this morning.
And they have 2 billion people in their country.
Yeah.
You know, second largest to China.
Right,
and,
right. And the most gracious people.
Could you imagine our country being...
No.
Totally. And we would,
And the power goes out sometimes, and nobody complains about it. Or even people that are affluent in India, the power goes off, and it just is. And
yeah, but not normally.
No, not normally. Not like this. This is something different.
Yeah. I just thought...
I heard that on the radio. So that was...
You got another image?
I have... this image here is a show that...
At the Clay on
I
Main.
I did this. This was an installation I did at Clay on Main. This piece was called Midden. I have another. This is the pods. This is, again, when I was trying to work with surfaces. This was really
it's
cool.
Like bread, doesn't
it? Yeah, this is
the
sand.
The top of the bread.
You can feel the sand because the sand doesn't melt. And this, the piece was called Midden, and I just wanted to look like these things were just unearthed, like somebody just dug them up and was working on them. And so see this cool tabletop here. Matthew and I couldn't find the table that I wanted, and I kept saying, I want it to look just like our work table. So I got the saw, and we cut my work table down. And this is
Matthew.
Matthew and I. He said, well, let's just cut the work table down. Said okay, so he made the base for me. I cut the work table down, and because this was a nice piece, I liked this piece a lot because I was trying to go for 313 of these pods, but I didn't get it. But I wanted
why
this
313?
That's our address, and it's a really good prime number.
313.
It's a good prime number. I like prime numbers, so I thought, and it's our address. I thought that's a good number. And these were also part of it. And they were like a midden, like, you know, a little squirrel midden or a trash midden. A midden is squirrels collect nuts and put them all in one place, and then you might find a whole
you
heap
mean
of...
their treasure, they're just storage.
Yeah, that's their midden. And then also when people, you know, anthropologists dig up trash dumps, sometimes they'll look through a midden, and it's like the cache of all of the trash heap that some like a shell midden, like a Native American shell midden you might find. And so that's what I kind of, that was why what I was thinking about with this piece is that this was, these were in a midden, this piece here. And these are some words I wrote about what midden was. And these were neat because every single one of these has a different surface on these little pods.
The exhibition space that Clay on Main has is incredible.
Thank you.
It's beautiful. And I mean, the work could take it over depending on how you put it up, but it doesn't have to. It's
well, that's why I thought this was fun to have this work. It was like a work image in this beautiful
space,
living room. So you have this domestic setting, and then you've got these funky things here going on. So, yeah, I was happy with that piece.
Do you have any other images there?
Let's see.
You got the early ones.
Yeah, I have some real early ones. I bought these just because this is sort of where my training led me early on. This is very traditional porcelain. This is hand painted on the surface, and even then I was trying to play with the surface. I didn't know where I was going with it, but this is underglazed pencil, so this is a pencil that actually fires on, and you can draw on it just like this. And then these are underglazed paints, so the little insects are just painted on. So that's early on. I did a ton of this stuff, a lot of these kinds of things, and they were
literally
fun.
Ton,
probably. I did a lot of those, and then this was when I thought I wanted to do figurative stuff, which I soon got over. This is my chicken goddess.
That went quickly.
I did a bunch of goddesses, but that went pretty quickly. This I stayed in for a while. This I liked a lot. This is very traditional, smoke-fired. Again, it's the traditional form where I threw it and burnished, and then it's just pit-fired. You just put it in a bucket of sawdust.
What's that thing going through?
This is a stick that was added later, and then these are some... Yeah, these are like little talisman pots. Yeah, like a handle sort of thing. Yeah, this is a tiny little pot. This is only maybe...
It looks like you have rings on it so that it come up.
It's just... You could hold it like that, but it just is a hole through. You know, they were just sort of... when my kids were little, I didn't have a whole lot of time to work in the studio, but I didn't stop. I kept doing stuff. And I would get asphalt trash... You know, empty asphalt cans worked really good. And you throw your pots in there and burn them in the sawdust overnight. And you get these beautiful, they're still lovely, but that came from very traditional stuff. This is where I started to get, you know, when I was working with the figurative stuff, this was a series that I did of insects that I created them in red clay, and then again I put them in this pit fire, I smoke fired them. And I liked this look, this black look. And I did that a lot. I smoke-fired, pit-fired stuff a lot. Then I started to try and design the glaze to look like that. This is the beginning of those real crusty, chunky glazes. Like the tile and the bowls. This was the first time I tried to start to... That thing that was in... Yeah, that one.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay.
And this was the image that eventually led me to this. So I worked from this sort of black and insect thing there, and then I did this, and then this is high fire too. These are up to about 2300 degrees. This again is a whole series of these things. But that's sort of
okay. Now then, here is this kind of
there's that thing.
Anteater, whatever.
Yeah, that was made in the blizzard. Sitting at home. This
made in what?
In the blizzard.
Oh.
Blizzard that we had in 96 or something.
You mean you needed some heat from an object, so you thought you'd build an object that would generate some heat.
Right. This little creature, there's seven of those. I rarely name my pieces. They're vase, they're pod, they're... Because that's...
What is this?
Those are the seven demons of Magdalene. Oh. Must have been...
Well,
there's seven of these.
Are they all working with this kind of abstract glaze?
They all have this shape, and they all have this...
The random colors are applied?
Yeah, what I actually was, the reason that I made these just because they were fun. This is neat here, too, because you see when I showed you that black pot that was pit-fired, this is pit-fired, but can you see that? Because that's kind of neat. This is pit-fired, but here, these stripes, you put masking tape on, and then you put it in the smoke. And where the masking tape is, you can actually control how it fires your piece. So you can get these really clean edges from something that's really...
It's almost like it's built into it,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
It's part of the fabric of the material.
Right. And I kind of like that. I like that. I was messing around with that.
Might not be as good all over it, but having it in a
yeah,
small part.
That's right. That's a little part like that. Just a little part like that. And then I put... I was messing with silver leaf to see if I could get it to work.
Oh, so this is yeah. silver leaf here.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You can get the coloration in clay in many ways. You can do lusters
What's
or whatever.
What's the black?
That's just the glaze. And then okay. and then I threw it in the, I pit fired it with the glaze on. So it's kind of like foku. Fake raku. So. But these are a series. That has a little hole in it because if not, it would blow up.
Yeah.
So, but the so that was kind of an interesting, fun series.
Well, depending on how you.
Yeah, they kind of walk around.
That's the way it walks.
There's six-legged creatures here. They look nice as a little herd. They're sort of like a herd.
Now you made how many of those? Seven.
Seven. Yeah, I made nine, but I only kept seven. Because again, they look neat in context. They give each other a context. You know, I really like African art. So I started to... Sometimes when I'm blocked, I look at things and try and recreate something historically, very literally. So I started to create this form, and I was actually going to do like a chief's chair, which had a reproduce a chief's chair, which was like a little torso and then hands holding the platform for the chief to sit on. And then I never finished it, and I started to. I have three of these. I
Could
started
we have
to look.
The camera on this?
I actually have about five of these, I think. And I just liked the idea that it was just a bit of a hole, just a part of a torso. You know, I didn't.
Well, it's the bottom.
Yeah, it's the bottom.
Bottom
you know?
Half from yeah, about the waist down.
And again, you have that whole idea: is it a vessel? Is it a sculpture? Is it, you know?
You know the element of African art, and then the Aborigine, which are very different because. There's a very social, ritualistic quality, mm-hmm. which you don't, the same kind of thing you don't find in mm-hmm. the African mm-hmm. art, mm-hmm. because they think of the Aborigines, they deal with the land as being very sacred to them, mm-hmm. more mm-hmm. in association mm-hmm. with the American Indian. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If I was to apply it. To the three, you know,
right.
it doesn't. African is different. Totally.
It's very different. It's very different, and I think that what I like about African art is not necessarily how they like Native American stuff. I think of as being related to the clay, related to the earth, and they work a lot in with clay. I mean, African art does with the big pots that women make and stuff, but. But sort of African art that's used in rituals or you know that is sacred. It's the strength of the image that I like.
We have a home viewer.
Uh huh.
Okay. Yes. Thank you for calling.
Do you have any classes at this art studio?
Classes? Yes, we do have classes. We have a website, clayonmaine.org, and that lists all of our classes. Yes.
Are they expensive?
No, they're not. They're $165 for 6 weeks. Everything is included. That's $27.50 a class, and the classes are 2.5 hours each, and we do make the studio available for you to work in at other times.
That sounds pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
All right, thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
That was a very good question.
Yeah, it was a good question. Thank you. We do list all that information on our website. We do a lot of things. We do shows, we do classes, we have music, we have special events, and all of our exhibitions are open to the public. So if you'd like to know more about us, just go on our website, clayonmaine.org, and you know, you're invited to come out and visit anytime you want.
Okay, we have also, this one is kind of interesting inside.
Well,
it's
that's coils.
Earthy.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, I don't work with traditional glazes too much anymore. And this one doesn't, this one has slip and no glaze on the inside. And what's really cool about this is I've really taken lately to working with what we call reslaked clay, reclaimed clay. All of the students leave me little bits of clay. I throw it in a bucket and I use it over. And if you don't wedge it up too much, that's where you get all these colors from. These are all the different colors of the clay. So it's kind of cool. And that's what's on the bottom of the bowls, the bottom back of the tiles. I don't wedge it together till it's so homogenized that you can't see the different colors of the clay. This one is taken to high temperature, and then the only finish. And the other thing that's cool about this, I don't know where this came from, but in, see these three little things here? In the clay, there must have been some low fire clay. This was taken to 2300 degrees. There must have been some clay that was lower temperature, and it just started to melt and popped out. Isn't that cool? That's the cool thing about clay. It just does stuff. I think that's why I keep going back to that material, because it's malleable, because you can just do a ton of stuff with it, and it takes any finish you want to give it. And that's why I keep going back to it, even though I mess around with other stuff.
Are you making anything for showing? Have you got any shows coming up?
I don't have any shows coming up. I'm pretty busy keeping Clay on Main together, but I do have, I have some new ideas. One thing that I'm thinking about is those tiles. I want to work on those tiles some more because I'm interested in doing them as paintings, and I want to work on a lichen glaze, a different surface texture, creating a different texture. So,
okay, then we're
these tiles here. Yeah. These are, and I have a whole new idea for a different kind of texture. Rather than this crazed, I'm trying to get a texture that would sort of lift more like in a flower petal, so it would look like lichen. So that's my new thing.
Still be rough?
Yeah, I'd like to keep that stony texture. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see how much I can control these textures so that I sort of have them at my fingertips like paints. You know, if I want to do a certain color, a certain pattern, I can just pull up these kind of textures. That's the clay that's inside. You know what that probably is when I poked the holes?
Yeah.
That's probably a little bead that popped in there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if you look here, see that reclaimed clay? You see all those different colors?
Uh-huh.
That's just because I didn't wedge the clay all completely together. That's a little porcelain and a little, there's probably a little black slip and red clay. And that's just the reclaimed clay.
Well, have anything we missed?
Oh,
Do you have any images that we missed?
These are kind of neat, these tiles. We could take a quick look at those. These are when I first started the tiles. Can we see this image?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I'm always interested in clay as a 2D surface, like thinking about it as a painting. And you can see I worked these in a series, and I cut them from the back. When I made these differently than I did those, I just made a chunk of clay, and I went back and I carved them out. And
those are solid?
No, these are hollow. They were solid. That's how I made them. I just cut them off a block of, like I made a block of clay and I just cut them off like this. Then I laid them down on the table and I went back with a sculpting tool and I just carved the back out real quickly. And I deliberately carved in some of these, let these be carved out from the back to create these. What happens is the clay melts down a little bit and falls down, and I let that happen. And then I just started to experiment with surface decoration there. So that's
okay. Well,
that's it.
I would like to thank you for coming and visiting.
Thank you.
And I would like to thank the audience for tuning in. And I'm James Carroll, and good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation and by Berks Arts Council.